Hi. Welcome back to session 5 of Principles of Economics of first semester VBA, Mangalore University. In this session, we are going to deal with macroeconomics. Concerning the nature of economics only. Macroeconomics, meaning of macroeconomics, features, importance, and limitations. In the previous session, we studied about microeconomics. Microeconomics basically means individual study, study of individual economic entities. That micro and macro, the two concepts were coined by Ragnar Frisch in 1933. Then we studied features of that microeconomics, importance of microeconomics and limitations. Let us proceed to next topic, macroeconomics, learning objectives and learner outcome, learning outcome. This is same for the entire chapter. Same slides are copied by the person who prepared this PPT. Everywhere the same thing, to give conceptual clarity on various concepts of economics, origin and growth of economics. Deals with the basic economic principles that help to understand the process of decision making by individuals. See, learning object means what is the purpose of studying these topics. Outcome, what will be the effect after listening to this lecture? You will be able to understand different concepts of economics and you can apply the same in the real day-to-day economic activities. Means day-to-day economic activities. I don't know what is a real day-to-day and what is macroeconomics? The term macroeconomics is derived from the Greek word makros, M-A-K-R-O-S, which means large. So macroeconomics is that branch of economics which deals with economy as a whole. On the contrary to microeconomics, here our approach is totally different. In microeconomics, we concentrated on individual aspects, whereas in macroeconomics, we are having the aggregate approach. The aggregate approach means the economic entities as a whole we are going to study, we are going to analyze. Such economic entities may consist of large individual aspects with individual differences. By ignoring all such individual differences, we are going to study the common externalities, common features of all these entities put together under macroeconomics. Macroeconomics is also called lumping method or income analysis, income theory. Lumping method means we are not going to deal with individual aspects separately and individually. Rather, we are going to study as a whole. It's also called income theory because its main aim is to understand the determination of income and employment. Macroeconomics mainly concentrates on factors determining employment and income. That's why it's also called income theory. Now let's study the definitions. Only one definition is there by K.E. Worlding. There are so many other definitions to macroeconomics. All those definitions are not included in this PPT. Okay, according to K.E. Worlding, macroeconomics is that part of the subject which deals with great aggregates and averages of system rather than a particular item in it. Macroeconomics is that part of the study of economics which deals with aggregates and averages. Aggregates and averages. Aggregate means as a whole. Average means observing average behavior of the system rather than a particular item. We are not going to deal with individual things separately and independently. Rather, we are going to study the things as whole. Features of macroeconomics. I think these PPTs are prepared by keeping those students in mind who struggle to get, you know, pass marks. Because there are so many other definitions of economics, macroeconomics, which were not included in this PPT. So just to get pass marks, this is sufficient. If you want to score good marks, you have to depend upon other things. You have to read books. You have to read reference books. This will give you just, you know, basic things. Those who are struggling to get pass marks, such people can depend upon these e-contents. Okay, what are the features of macroeconomics? One, study of aggregates. It studies aggregate aspects rather than individual things. Aggregate aspects such as economy, industry, group of individuals, the whole sector as such. For example, industrial sector consists of large varieties of industries. And a particular type of industry may consist of large number of firms. We are not going to deal with these individual firms or individual industries. We are going to deal with the industrial sector as a whole. So that is what is called study of aggregates. The study of agriculture sector. An agriculture sector consists of different varieties of crops, different levels of farmers, different crops. We are not going to deal with these individual crops. We are not going to deal with the problem of individual farmer, but the agriculture sector as a whole. That is why it's called study of aggregates. Secondly, it studies general equilibrium analysis. General equilibrium means attainment of equilibrium by all individual sectors simultaneously. General equilibrium analysis studies the attainment of equilibrium by the economy as a whole. An economy as a whole attains equilibrium when all individual entities in that economy simultaneously attain equilibrium. That leads to general equilibrium. Equilibrium means a state of condition where there is no tendency to change. So macroeconomics is general equilibrium analysis. Third, importance to income. It gives primary importance to income. That is why it's also called income theory. Income theory means the entire macroeconomics focuses on the determinants of income and employment. What determines employment? What determines income? See here, level of employment and level of income is nothing but level of economic activities, or in simple, performance of an economy. What determines the performance of an economy? Whether a country is developed or underdeveloped or developing or poor or rich, what determines? What are the factors that contribute for this particular level of income? That is focused by the macroeconomics. Then a total study. Total study means what? Totality. Study of totality. It is not total study. Study of totality. Aggregates. An aggregate system consists of a number of individual things, individual aspects. From individual, see, within this, you know, within these individual things, there may be differences. For example, firms. Large number of firms may face different types of problems. We are not going to deal with all these individual problems of individual firms. Rather than we are going to study the problems of industry as a whole. That is why it's called a totality, study of the totality. Next, a dynamic in nature. Macroeconomics recognizes the influence of time. When time changes, remember that many aspects are undergoing to change. When time changes, technology changes, tastes and preferences, level of income, demand factors, all these things undergo change. That is why macroeconomics is more realistic than microeconomics. Dynamic in nature means it considers changes. Economies are ever changing. Economies are changing. You know, The way when time changes, technology changes. When technology changes, cost of production, level of output, all those things undergo change. Lastly, macroeconomics gives us bird's eye view. Bird's eye view means the aggregate view. A bird flying on the sky, how it visualizes the earth, how it sees the earth. So that's all. So macroeconomics is the study of forest rather than individual trees. A forest consists of varieties of trees, shrubs, plants, etc., etc. Each individual tree is unique in its sense. Macroeconomics is not going to deal with these individual trees rather than the forest as such. Importance of macroeconomics. It gives complete picture of the economy. Macroeconomics is going to give us the total functioning of an economy, how an economy functions, what are the different sectors of the economy, how these different sectors are interrelated, what are the give and take relationship that exists among these different sectors of the economy, like that. So it gives the holistic approach, the aggregate picture of, complete picture of an economy. Second, it gives an insight into economic theory. Insights into economic theory, I can't understand this one. Insights into economic theory is what? It gives an insight into economic theory. I doubt whether the person who prepared this PPT really studied economics or not. Insights into economic theory. Macroeconomics gives new insight into the study of economic theory. We have to accept individual differences. But if you concentrate on individual differences, you cannot study the behavior of an economy as such. Formulation of economic policies. Macroeconomics is highly useful in formulating economic policies. Economic policies are nationwide policies. We cannot prepare economic policies for individuals. We cannot prepare, say for example, industrial policy. Industrial policy cannot be prepared for each individual industry or firm. For all firms put together, industrial policies are required to be prepared. Similarly, agricultural price policy. Similar trade policy, all these policies are required to be prepared by keeping the entire economy in mind rather than individual commodities, individual firms, etc. So in that sense, macroeconomics is highly useful to us. Measurement of national income, importance in measuring national income. An economy is a complex whole where different sectors are engaged in generating national income. People depend upon different activities. People carry on different types of economic activities and thereby earn their income. So how to measure national income? What are the complexities? What are the different sectors of the economy where people organize different types of economic activities? How they earn income? What are the different sectors? All those things are going to be studied under their macroeconomics. So how to measure national income? Fifth one, importance, formulation of business cycle theory. How that macroeconomics helps in formulating business cycle theory, I don't know. It studies business cycle. Macroeconomics is helpful in understanding business cycle theories. It's not formulation. Rubbish things are there. Macroeconomics studies how that business cycle theories, it studies about the business cycle theory. Business cycle studies fluctuations in level of economic activities over a period of time. How an economy experiences prosperity and depression. How an economy moves from depression to prosperity and experiences recovery and again from prosperity to depression through that recession. What are the factors responsible for such fluctuations in the level of economic activities? What are the adverse effects? How to minimize the adverse effects of these business cycles all those things are studied under that macroeconomics. So business cycle is an important, business cycle theories are important and integral part of macroeconomics. It's helpful to understand economic problems. Macroeconomics is highly useful in understanding economic problems. Economic problems such as income inequality, poverty, unemployment. These are all aggregate economic problems. Income inequality is not the individual problem. It's a problem of the economy as such. Poverty, for example, poverty is not an individual problem of an individual in the society. Poverty is a problem of the entire nation. So how to eradicate that poverty? What type of policies are required to be implemented? Then scientific investigation. Macroeconomics makes scientific investigation. It investigates the functioning of an economy, complexity of an economy in a scientific manner. Scientific investigation means what? Macroeconomics goes for scientific approach, that's all. Okay, though that macroeconomics is highly useful, it is not free from certain drawbacks and defects. So what are the problems of that macroeconomics? It neglects individual or unit. Neglect of individual or unit. Macroeconomics neglects individual aspects. It aims at too generalization. That excessive generalization simply overlooks and neglects individual aspects. Second one, difficult to get a true picture of the economy. It gives overall picture, whereas that overall picture may not be the true picture. Overall picture may not be the true picture. Just for example, by looking at national income, you decide whether a country is developed or developing country or a poor country. By looking at national income, if you conclude that an economy is developed one, this may not be the actual picture. This may not be the true picture of the economy. Maybe in that economy, two individuals are multi-crore business magnates, whereas remaining 98% of the total population are poor. The economy may be considered as a developed country by looking at national income, but in that national income, 98% of that national income is contributed by two individuals. The remaining 98% of people live over that, they are in the status of poverty. By looking at this, you cannot say that it's a developed country, because large majority, 98% of the total population, are falling under below the poverty line. So this cannot give you correct picture. Then it neglects individual differences. Individual aspects they differ from each other. Maybe two firms, but the problem, intensity of the problem, factors or causes for such problems may differ from individual to individual. Macroeconomics overlooks all such individual differences. Macroeconomics neglects individual differences. This is not the proper way of expression. Neglect of individual differences. Then, failure to provide a real picture of the economy. The same thing repeated as the second one. Difficult to get a true picture. Real picture, true picture, actual picture, they're all one and same. So that's why I said, don't depend upon these PPTs and the contents. It's better to go for reference books. Failure to provide a real picture of the economy. See, what you see may not be the true picture. Given the example of that economy, a rich country, where only two individuals contributing the entire national income, and 98% are the falling under below poverty line. By looking at this, you cannot come to the conclusion that the economy is a rich country. So failure fails to provide a real picture of the economy. That's same as the difficult to get a true picture of the economy. Two same point repeated in two different situations. Okay, estimation of variables is difficult. Estimation of variables, understanding variables, it's not an easy task. In that way, how to put it? Macroeconomic variables are difficult to estimate. In that way, how to put? Estimation of variables is difficult. No. Macroeconomic variables are very difficult to estimate. Say, for example, national savings. What is that national savings? Savings of the entire nation. Remember that for an individual, saving is essential. But if the entire nation saves, then it will lead to problem of oversupply. See, this is the macroeconomic paradox. This is the macroeconomics paradox. For an individual, remember that saving is wise. Saving is virtue. Right? So that by going for savings, you can preserve income for future use. But if the entire nation saves, then that nation may face the problem of overproduction. There will not be any demand. Effective demand will be less. Remember that macroeconomics overlook such problems. So estimation of variables is difficult. Okay, according to the person who prepared this PPT, these are the reference books. The term macroeconomics is derived from same question as microeconomics, same thing, nothing new in that Greek word. Macroeconomics is a study of small, big, large, medium, aggregate. Neither big nor large, aggregate. Macroeconomics is called lumping methods. The word macroeconomics is coined by Ragnar Frisch. Same question, okay. What are the important features of macroeconomics? Aggregate supply, limit study, half study. Aggregate study, limit study, half study, partial study. I don't know the meaning of limit study, half study, partial. Partial study is okay. Aggregate study is okay. Half study means? Limit study means maybe the person who is to read only one book or two book and prepare the PPT. Maybe that one is called limit study. One of the important features of macroeconomics is aggregate study. Okay, that is the end of the session 5. We'll meet in next session 6.